The Armless Maiden by Midori, Snyder. There was once a husband and wife who lived beside a great forest. They were not royalty, but neither were they poor. Their house was built of fine white stone, and they looked out upon their gardens and fields from windows of glass. There was much love between this couple, and in time there were children as well. The firstborn was a son, called Richard, and he had his father's dark hair and night-black eyes. The secondborn was a daughter, Marion, born fair as her mother before her, with hair the color of the sun. The white stones of the house echoed with the sounds of the family, the husband rousing his hounds and servants to the hunt, the clattering of the wife's spinning wheel, and the bright sound of the children's laughter. But time passed like clouds beneath the sun, first bright, then dark, and it happened one fall that the wife took ill, and with the first soft drifting of winter's snow she died. They buried her at the garden's edge, and in the brittle soil the husband planted a rose bush, covering the tender roots with leaves to shelter it against the cold. Day into night and night into day, the husband knew only the stab of grief. He sat by the hearth and stirred the fire, thinking of his sorrow, and so great was his grief that he forgot all else, even his children. In the spring, the rosebush sent forth its first shoots. The children watched as branches lifted warily from the soil, their thick gray boughs covered in black thorns. The summer came, and the rosebush spread, becoming a grove of thorns. There were no flowers, no green stems or leaves, and though the summer sun was bright and warm, in the shadow cast by their father's grief there could be only winter. So Richard and Marion passed their childhood, each the only companion for the other, and all laughter and joy was shared in secret between them. They promised then never to marry and never to leave the other. One spring came, and their father, aged by his grief, died. Richard buried him in the far corner of the garden. The new sunlight was hot against the straining muscles of his back, and sweat streaked his face. As he bent to brush the dirt from his hands, he looked up across the garden and stared in amazement. There, trapped amidst the grove of thorns, was a young woman struggling to free herself. She strained against the thorny claws, and her brown hair was snarled in its fierce grip. "Help me, please," she pleaded. Richard dropped his shovel and, with long, quick strides, came to the woman. As he lifted the heavy boughs of thorns to free her, he stared into her green eyes and felt a longing he had not known before. She smiled at him, stepping lightly from the tangled web of thorns, and gratefully placed her hands in his. "Who are you?" Richard asked. "Fiona," she replied, and smiled again. Her green eyes sparkled, and Richard was drawn into the cool gaze. "But how did you get here?" Fiona did not answer, but held tight to his hands. Again Richard asked, and again Fiona refused to answer, but only laughed, a sweet sound like rushing water. And with that sound nothing else mattered to Richard. He wanted forever to hear Fiona laugh, and to gaze into her emerald-colored eyes. Richard brought Fiona home to the stone house, and introduced her to Marion. "Sister, I met a woman by the grove. I mean to marry her." "As you wish," Marion answered simply, but her gray eyes filled with the sadness she felt, for Fiona's smile was sharp as thorns, and her green eyes were bright with jealousy. Richard claimed he could not rest until he and Fiona were wed. So, in haste, they were married, and as they left the chapel, Marion's heart grew heavy with dread. Time passed like a spinning coin, first bright and then dull. Marion did her best to welcome Fiona and to please her brother as before, but now Richard found only fault with her. The stitches on his shirt were clumsy, the meat she cooked was dry and tasteless, and the butter she churned curdled. Everything Marion put her hand to came undone, and always there was Fiona's cold green eyes following her, triumphant each time Marion failed. One night in their bed, Fiona whispered into Richard's ear, "Send your sister away. She is a burden to us." "Where would she go?" asked Richard. "Why do you care?" Fiona said spitefully. "No," Richard shook his head. "She is still my sister. Her faults are small." The next morning, Fiona rose from her bed crying. "Husband dear," she said, "I dreamed that Marion has emptied your barrels of wine." "It was a dream," Richard replied sleepily, but Fiona shook him. "Go and see for yourself." Richard went to the cellar, and there were the barrels of wine, their sides smashed open, and red wine spilled over the cellar floor. Richard turned away from the sight, anger pricking his heart like a thorn, but he said nothing. The next morning, Fiona rose again, crying out, "Husband, dear husband, I dreamed that your sister Marion has murdered your hounds and left their bodies by the hearth." "It was a dream," Richard replied, wary this time. "Go and see for yourself," Fiona demanded as before. Richard entered the great hall, and there on the hearthstones were his hounds, their limp bodies covered with blood. And again anger stabbed his breast, but still he said nothing to Marion. On the next morning, Fiona rose and shook her husband awake with piercing cries of anguish. "What is it, wife?" Richard asked, frightened by Fiona's shrill wailing. "I dreamed that Marion has murdered our son." "It is but a dream," Richard replies, though his face grew pale. Fiona turned to him, her green eyes red-rimmed with weeping. "Go and see for yourself." Richard rushed to his son's cradle. The white linens were stained red, but there was no child to be seen. Then he threw back his head and howled in rage. From her room, Marion shook with fear. The night before, Fiona had given her candles that burned with such thick smoke that Marion had not been able to rouse herself from her bed, even when she saw Fiona come to her in the night and lay the small body beside her in the bed. Richard's anguished cry had released her from Fiona's spell, and now there was blood on her sheets, blood on the sleeves of her nightdress, and on her pillow was laid the body of her murdered nephew and a silver blade. Richard burst through the door of her room, his sword drawn. His black eyes glittered with malice. Marion could find no words to speak, and he accepted her silence as confession of her guilt. Richard dragged Marion by the hair across the garden until he came to the grove of thorns. "Brother," she gasped, clinging to his wrist. "Brother, please listen to me." "No," Richard shouted as he drew her up. "I will not." She raised her hand to touch him, but he swung his sword and struck her right arm from her body. Marion gave a startled cry as the arm fell lifeless on the branches. "And does it give you pain, my sister?" he shouted. Marion nodded, weeping. "It is the same that you gave to my hounds." Richard raised his sword and struck her other arm from her body. "And again, does it hurt you, sister?" Marion nodded. "It is the same hurt that you gave my son," he said bitterly. "I will leave you here to die in this grove." "I did not kill them," Marion said softly. "It was your own bride who did these things." Her golden hair fell across her face like threshed wheat. The blood from her shoulders spiraled around her waist. Slowly, Marion lifted her head and spoke. "Before you leave this grove, my brother, you will step on a thorn, and none but my hand shall free you of it." Richard turned angrily from her, and seeing Fiona waiting for him in the courtyard, he began to hurry his steps. As he took the last step out of the grove, a thorn on a low-lying branch pierced his boot and entered the heel of his foot. Richard ignored the stab of pain, seeing only Fiona's smiling face beckoning him away from the grove. In the grove of thorns, Marion wept with sorrow. The tears trickled down her cheeks, and where they fell on the thorn bush, a few green leaves appeared. With the twilight came the dew, and the soft drops of healing water staunched the bleeding and soothed her wounds. Marion stopped her crying, and following the lighted path of the moon, entered into the forest. Time passed like the slanting of moonlight in the forest, first silver, now black. Marion wandered through the trees, her feet treading warily along an unknown path. The animals came to her, for she was a strange creature that, unlike other men, had no arms with which to hurt them. At night she lay down among the deer, their warm hides sheltering her from the night's chill. Birds and squirrels brought her berries and hulled nuts, leaving them on stones where she might bend to eat. But it was not enough. How she longed for the sound of a human voice, for the kind touch of another's hand on her cheek. She was growing thin with hunger, her clothing was torn and ragged, and her once golden hair was a dirty brown, matted with moss and twigs. And then one morning she was awakened by the scent of apples carried on the breeze. She followed the sweet aroma until she came to a wall of stones. Looking up, she saw apple trees, their boughs laden with ripe fruit. Her mouth watered at the memory of the taste. Quickly she began searching for an opening along the stone wall, and found a tunnel that an animal had furrowed out beneath the wall. It was a narrow tunnel, and she wriggled through it, her body covered with dirt, and her face scratched by the small stones. So great was Marion's hunger that she didn't care, but forced her way through to the promise of apples on the other side. Once in the orchard, Marion tried to stand, but she was too weak from hunger. Instead, she rolled herself to the base of a tree and ate the apples that had fallen on the ground. After Marion had eaten, a measure of strength returned to her, and she was able to sit up, leaning gratefully against the trunk of an apple tree. From where she sat, Marion could see the tall spires of a castle rising over the treetops. On the spires, blue and green flags snapped gaily in the wind. Suddenly, Marion heard loud voices. Servants were coming to the orchard to gather apples. Fearful of being seen, Marion fell to the ground and tried to roll away to the stone wall again. "Look, over there!" Marion heard someone shout, and her heart began to race. "What kind of animal is it?" another shouted. "Quick, catch it!" Marion was surrounded by servants, their eyes staring curiously at her. One man held a long stick, prepared to strike her if she proved dangerous. "Please," Marion called, "please help me." "Bless me, it can speak," said a serving woman, and she came a little closer. "Careful now," the man with the stick warned. "I mean no harm," Marion answered. Another man pushed through the circle of servants, and they straightened as he spoke. "What is it?" he demanded. "My prince," said the servant with the stick, "we found a creature in your orchard stealing apples." "I wasn't stealing them," Marion answered angrily. "How can I steal apples when I have no hands?" Tears brimmed in her eyes. The man approached her and bent to look into her face. As she gazed back, Marion felt a mixture of gladness and shame, for the man was young and handsome. His eyes were a clear blue, and the look he gave her was one of kindness, but also pity. How wretched I must seem to him, she thought, and quickly lowered her eyes. "This is no creature," the young man said softly, "but a woman. Bring her back to the castle. There is nothing that can be done for her wounds, but at least she can be washed and fed." "As you wish, my prince," the servant answered, and Marion felt herself being lifted from the ground and carried through the orchard. Only then did she raise her eyes to follow the young man's back, with his broad shoulders that tapered into a narrow waist. The serving women scrubbed Marion's skin with sand and soap, taking off the forest dirt and dried blood. Twice they washed her hair and combed out the tangles until it shone again like newly spun gold. "But she is a pretty child," one woman murmured to another. "Too bad about her arms." They dressed her in a blue gown, and over her shoulders they draped a cloak of soft green, so that it seemed her arms were not missing at all. When Marion entered the great hall and stood before the prince, she saw his eyes open wide with surprise. He came down from his throne and looked at her closely. "Can it be that you are the same creature from the orchard?" "Yes," she answered quietly, shy in his presence. "Tell me how you came to be like this," he said gently, and drew her to a chair. Marion's voice trembled at first, and then grew steady as she told the prince of Fiona's treachery and Richard's cruel attack. The prince's face darkened with anger. "Be at rest," he said firmly. "There is no one here that will harm you. That I promise." Marion smiled at the prince, and in his eyes she saw pity ignite the spark of love. They spent their days walking through the gardens of the castle, sharing their thoughts, and finding happiness in each other's company. The prince saw to it that Marion was well cared for. Servants dressed her each day, combed her hair, and the prince himself fed her slices of bread dipped in milk. At times her helplessness troubled Marion, but she was too dazed by her good fortune to remain worried. All who saw Marion and the prince together nodded their heads, knowing it would not be long before the prince offered marriage. Indeed, soon after in the garden, he crowned Marion with a wreath of white roses and asked if she would be his bride. And though Marion's heart was overjoyed, a sliver of doubt remained. "I am not whole, my prince. Can you love me as I am?" Marion asked. "Always," the prince replied. "Then I accept," said Marion, and banished all doubt from her heart. The king and queen approved of the match, though secretly they had hoped the prince would marry someone else, a woman with arms, at least. The prince and Marion were married quietly, with only the servants and the king and queen present to bear witness. The prince placed Marion's wedding ring on a gold chain around her neck. Time passed like the summer flowers, first blooming and then fading. One day a messenger arrived, bringing the prince news of war, and though he hated the thought of leaving Marion, newly pregnant with their first child, the prince was obliged to go. As he packed his supplies, he called on the king and queen to guard well his wife and to write as soon as the child was born. Marion watched a servant hold the stirrup steady for the prince as he mounted his horse. "That should be my duty," she thought sadly as she stood helplessly beside his horse. The prince bent down and kissed her on the forehead, and then he was gone, the steel of his armor glistening in the sun as he rode away. Marion felt the tears that washed her cheeks and waited for the servant to wipe them away. When the time came, Marion gave birth to a beautiful son, his face shining like the moon, his hair like threads from the sun. The queen wrote to the prince to give him the glad tidings. She entrusted the letter to a serving man and sent him on his way through the woods to where the prince was engaged in battle. The way was long and tiring, and when the servant came upon a fine house made of white stone with windows of glass, he decided to stop and rest. He knocked on the door, and a woman answered, startling him with her bright green eyes. "Come in," she cried. "I have been without company since the war began. Let me offer you food and wine. I am called Fiona," she said sweetly. The tired servant was grateful for a meal and joined her at the table. There was roasted chicken and beef, bowls of vegetables and creamy sauces, and all nature of sweet cakes. Fiona poured the servant a glass of wine, and they began to talk. "What brings you here?" she asked. The servant saw no harm in answering and told Fiona of the prince and his wife, a woman fair to look at but with no arms. He told her of the letter he was carrying with the news of the birth of their first child. So intent was the servant on his plate of food that he did not see the hard gleam in Fiona's green eyes, nor the way her hands tightened into angry fists. Over and over she poured the wine until the servant had drunk so much that he grew tired, and, laying his head in the crook of his arm, fell asleep. Fiona slipped the letter from his pouch and read it quickly. Then she tossed it on the fire and sat down to write a new one. When that was done, she carefully tucked the new letter into the servant's bag. In the morning she woke the servant and sent him on his way with a loaf of bread and cheese. "Please stop this way on your return," she said to him, "and I shall see that you are well fed once more." The servant agreed to the pleasant offer and hurried on his way to the prince. At the battle camp, the servant approached the prince with his letter. The prince looked weary, blood rusting on his bright armor. The servant was pleased to think he had brought good news and hoped he would be well rewarded. He gave the prince the letter and waited. The prince read the letter, his eyes moving eagerly at first over the words. Then, abruptly, they clouded with pain, and to the servant's astonishment, he saw the prince become haggard. "Your wife has given birth to a monster," Fiona had written, "an armless monster so terrifying that no one can look upon him without fear, and now your wife sleeps with this monster in the stables and feeds like an animal at the kitchen door." The prince folded the letter, and the servant saw how his hand trembled, but the prince called for paper and a pen to write a reply. "As before," the prince wrote, "take care of my wife and child. Give them shelter and all that they need.
When I return, I will see what is to be done. He folded the letter and gave it to the servant. Go now with and return to the castle, he said sharply. But prince, the servant protested, I have traveled a long way. Am I to get no rest, nothing to eat? Go now, the prince ordered, and his armor rattled dangerously. The servant left with the new letter, grumbling as he did. Well, he thought, at least I can stop the night at that house. The mistress there will see to it that I am well fed. And the servant marched quickly, thinking of roast beef and sweet wine. Well met, good man, Fiona called out when she saw the servant approaching. And are you returning from the prince? Indeed I am. The ungrateful man gave me no reward for my labor, just penned his reply and sent me on my way without so much as a thank you. Too bad, Fiona chuckled sympathetically. Come in and eat. I have a lamb here that is done to a turn and needs only to be eaten. The servant was happy to sit and eat, and he didn't mind as Fiona poured glass after glass of wine. And then, when he felt overcome at last with food and wine, he laid his head in the crook of his arm on the table and slept. Fiona withdrew the letter and read. She hissed angrily when she read the prince's words. No, she whispered. This will not do. I shall give you another answer and settle it once and for all. She took a new piece of paper and wrote. I no longer care for my wife or child. I can see now how foolish I was to love a creature with no arms, one that cannot even feed herself. I do not wish to see them on my return. Send them away into the woods where they belong. Smiling to herself, Fiona folded the letter and placed it in the servant's bag. The servant arrived at the castle in the morning and handed the prince's letter to the king. At least the king knows how to reward a good servant, the man thought, and great was his surprise when the king stood angrily and waved the servant away. What shall we do? The king asked the queen. Marion is a good girl, but our son is right. She can do nothing for herself. Even the child must be cared for by another. She sighed unhappily. We must have been mistaken when we approved of this marriage. Marion was called for, and when she came, the king showed her the letter. Marion's cheeks paled and her eyes glistened with unshed tears. She remembered her doubt and felt the pain of it now in her heart. But she raised her chin, and when she spoke, her voice was clear and strong. I shall leave. I ask only that you tie my son to my back. At least leave the baby, the queen pleaded. We can give him to a serving woman to raise. You will not be able to care for him. No, he is my child. I shall care for him. Tie him to my back, and I shall leave. A servant helped Marion to change her clothes. She left behind the gowns of silk and linen and the finely embroidered shoes. She wore only a brown woolen shift, and her feet were bare. Her little son was tied with a length of white cloth to her back, and he slept with his cheek pressed against her shoulder. She walked with head held high past the line of whispering servants and through the gates of the castle wall. Without a glance backwards, Marion entered again into the forest. And only when she was alone among the trees did she weep bitterly. She walked along the unknown paths, letting her feet take her deeper into the forest. The baby woke hungry and began to cry. Marion bent her face, her cheeks flushed, but there was nothing she could do. The baby on her back was there to stay, for without arms there was no way she could take him down and feed him. The baby soiled his diapers, and Marion could feel the wetness seeping through the length of cloth and making her back cold. But still she walked on, and when his cries grew weaker and more piteous, Marion felt her heart would break. The night came, and weary with walking and crying, Marion sat, bowing her head on her knees to sleep. The baby on her back slept, too, though his arms thrashed beneath the tight bounds of the cloth. When she woke, Marion was weak with hunger, and her lips were parched with thirst. She stood, and the baby, roused by her movements, began to cry again for food. Marion continued walking, searching for the tiny pockets of water that collected in the crevices of rocks, but the rocks were dry, and even the lichens had faded to a brittle gray. Desperation drove Marion through the brambles, until at last her feet stepped onto a path overhung with ferns about the edges. She stared at it, puzzled at first, and then made up her mind to follow it. The sweet trill of a bird led her on, reassuring her as she traveled the ferny path. Late in the day, as the sun was dipping behind the trees, Marion heard the sound of water lapping against the shore. It was a soft rustling noise, and her feet hurried down the path. As she pushed through the branches, she gasped, seeing before her the smooth crystal surface of a lake. In the fading sunlight, the water glowed like a jewel. Marion bent over a rock and peered into the water. She could see no bottom, only the shining surface of the water reflecting the image of her weary face and the baby, his tear-stained cheek resting on her shoulder. She stared long at the reflection of her face, arrested by the changes time had worked. Her features were still pretty, her hair bright gold, but her eyes were lined with sadness. And an old pain returned, the memory throbbing in her shoulders. Would the shame and sorrow of that moment never leave her? She stared at herself in the clear water and wished in her heart for wholeness. The water stirred, inviting her to drink. She bent slowly and carefully, afraid now that the baby might slip from her back. Her lips were close to the water when the baby woke and began to struggle on her back.
The cloth came undone, and in an instant the baby tumbled in with hardly a splash. "No!" Marion cried, and she dove into the water after her son. She shuddered as the icy cold water closed around her. She opened her eyes and saw her baby slowly drifting down, the water swirling around him with bubbles of quicksilver. Marion kicked her legs, but it was not enough to reach him. Her lungs burned, demanding air, but still she kicked, driving her body downward toward her baby. And then, before her, a huge fish threshed the water with shimmering waves. Its scales were pale green, tipped with silver. Its amber eyes stared curiously at her. From its gaping mouth hung two long whiskers. "As spirit of this lake, I would save you if you wish. Or I can save your child. You must choose," said the fish, its whiskers quivering as it spoke. "My arms," Marion cried. "Give me hands and I will save us both." The fish paused, its tail slowly undulating as it thought, and then it thrashed, arching its spine as it dove again to the bottom of the lake. The water began to seethe and boil, churning Marion over and over in a whirlpool of silvery water. Her shoulders tingled as if tiny fishes rubbed their scaled sides across her old wounds. She searched through the churning water, trying to see her baby, and when she saw him still drifting, his moon-white face upturned, she gave a desperate cry and lunged toward him. With no other thought but to save him, Marion reached out and saw a hand, her own hand, plunge through the churning water. She reached again, this time with her other hand, and, clutching her baby to her breast, she swam upward. As their heads broke the surface, Marion gave a cry of joy. The baby sputtered and coughed and then cried. She lifted him out of the water, marveling at the sight of her two hands, fingers clasped around his chest. On the shore again, Marion cradled her son, marveling at the heavy feel of his body in the crook of her arms. She nursed him, one hand stroking his cheek until he slept. But the newness of her arms kept her awake, and so she tickled him until he cried, and then she hugged him again, lifting him to her face as she kissed his soft, downy cheeks. Then she rocked him back to sleep, and when she lay down, she hugged him close within the shelter of her arms. In the morning when she woke, Marion had decided she would return, but not to the castle, not yet. With her child on her back, she faced the silent lake to offer thanks and farewell. The water stirred, and from the depths she saw the huge fish rising. Its whiskers floated along the surface of the water, and it spoke to her. "There is no need of thanks. It was your own courage that reached out and took back that which was once severed from you. Grafted again to the old stalk, the new tree bears fruit. Go in peace," the fish rumbled. Then it leapt high into the air, its huge jade-green body breaching the surface of the lake. It flashed brightly and then was gone. Just a circle of tiny waves marked its passing. Marion followed the ferny path away from the lake until she came to a poor woodcutter's cottage. The woodcutter was old, and as he lived alone, he agreed to let Marion and her son stay. She tucked her skirts up and with a broom swept the cottage clean. Next, she kneaded the dough and set the round loaves to baking. She mended the woodcutter's torn clothes and then fed his chickens and pig, and when that was done, she settled down with her son to wait. Time passed like flashing swords, first sharp and then blunt. The prince returned from the war, weary with killing and anxious to see his wife and son. "But she is gone," the king told him. "You told us to send her into the forest." "Never," the prince shouted. "You told me she had given birth to a monster. I told you to care for them until I returned." "Someone has lied to all of us," the queen cried out. The prince called the servant before him. "Tell me," the prince demanded, "did you stop anywhere before delivering the messages?" "Yes," the servant answered fearfully. "A house in the forest. A woman named Fiona gave me food." The prince groaned, for he knew well Fiona's name and could guess what she had done. "And did you sleep there?" "Yes, my prince," the servant answered wretchedly, bowing his head. "Then you will not sleep again until my wife is found," the prince answered. "Go and pack the horses. We shall search for her." "But surely you cannot hope to find her," the king said gently. "How would she have survived?" But the prince refused to believe that Marion was dead. "I would know it in my heart," he told the servant, "and my heart tells she is still alive." The servant wasted no time in saddling two horses. Together he and the prince left the castle and headed into the deep woods. They searched for days, never stopping long to eat, never resting more than a brief moment. They turned over the bushes for signs, looked into the mouths of caves, and watched for branches that had been bent to permit a woman to pass. One morning, after the forest mist had cleared and the sun was lighting the forest floor, the prince looked up to see a thin line of blue smoke rising over the trees. Though exhausted, he urged his horse through a clearing, where he saw the smoke coming from a cottage chimney. As he entered the clearing, the prince's lips parted in surprise. A woman, her back to him, played with a child. She stood in a circle of sunlight, and her long hair shimmered like gold down her back. She was laughing, and the sound of it pierced the prince's heart with recognition. He wanted to run to her, turn her around, and look into her face. But he didn't, confused by what he saw. With the sleeves of her dress pushed back, the prince saw she had arms and long white hands that tossed the happy child into the air and caught him again as he fell. The prince approached the woman, each step more eager and confused. The woman turned at the sound of his horse, and when the prince saw her face, he stopped in astonishment. "Marion," he sighed with relief, "I've been searching for you." "You sent me away," Marion answered softly. At this, the servant rushed before Marion and fell to his knees. Grabbing the hem of her dress, he began pleading for her forgiveness. Marion clasped him by the shoulders and raised him. Seeing the miracle of her hands made the servant more miserable, and the words of his confession rushed out of his mouth in furious haste. At the mention of Fiona's name, Marion's hands gripped his shoulders more tightly. But when he was done speaking, Marion released him, and again the servant begged for Marion's forgiveness. She nodded, one hand on his shoulder, and granted him her forgiveness. "Come home, Marion," the prince said. "Not yet," replied Marion, smiling sadly. "When I first came to you, I was a creature of the woods. You pitied me and gave me shelter. But now I am a woman, and you must court me as a woman." The prince nodded, understanding, and though he was reluctant to leave her, he mounted his horse and bid her goodbye. "Tomorrow," he promised. The next morning, the woodcutter woke Marion, shaking her excitedly by the shoulder. "Come and see, mistress, come quick." Marion came to the door and saw the line of horses, each laden with bridal gifts. There were bolts of fine silk and creamy white linen, a chest of gold coins, and baskets of silver dishes. There were geese, brood hens, a milk cow, and a fine bull with orange speckled hide. The queen left her horse, and Marion saw that she carried a small crown of sapphires. She placed the crown on Marion's head, and there were tears in her eyes as she took Marion by the hands and kissed her on the cheeks. "Take what you need," Marion said to the woodcutter, "for you have been kind and generous to me and my son." Marion mounted a gray horse, his mane braided with little bells. The woodcutter lifted up her son, and as she took him, his chubby hands eagerly reached out to jingle the bells. With one white arm around her son and the other holding the reins of her horse, Marion returned to the castle. They were married the next day, and this time the church was crowded. Marion wore a dress of white silk stitched about the neck and sleeves with tiny pearls and stars of sapphire. The prince stood straight and tall, his blue eyes shining at the sight of her. And when he placed the ring of gold on her finger, Marion sighed. "Now we are well and truly wed," she said, smiling at the prince. The bells pealed loudly the joy of the day, and only her son cried, afraid at first of their booming voices. But one thing yet troubled Marion. "I wish to go to my brother," Marion told the prince. "I must go and see him." The prince was not pleased at this request, but he would not refuse his wife. They rode their horses through the woods until they came to the white stone house. Marion looked around sadly. It had become ravaged and poor in the time she was gone. Nothing grew in the gardens, and only a few starving chickens scratched at the dust that swirled around her feet. Marion called at the door and heard a weak voice answer. She pushed open the door and entered into the hall. She saw no one, but the frail voice continued to call her forth. She walked through the musty, empty house until she came to the kitchen, and there, sitting in the ashes of a cold hearth, Marion found her brother Richard. From the single thorn in his heel, a bush of thorns had sprouted, covering all but his face with a dense thicket of branches and thorns, and with every move he made, the thorns dug into his arms and sides. His skin seemed as pale and lifeless as the prison of thorns surrounding him. Richard looked at her from eyes that were hollowed with pain and sadness. "Though I do not deserve it, forgive me, sister," he asked. With tears, Marion rushed to his side, and kneeling, she plucked the single thorn from his heel. No sooner was it removed than the thorns about his body began to wither. The fierce branches curled and dried into brittle twigs. What was left of the thorns fell away and Richard was freed. Weakly, Richard bent on his knees and took Marion by the hands. He shook his head in amazement. "I was blind, foolish, and cruel. I know now what manner of woman I married, and my own deeds were no better than hers. But these hands that once I took from you have given back to me my life." "Where is Fiona?" Marion asked. "I am here," a sharp voice answered. Marion saw Fiona standing in the shadow of the kitchen. "But you won't have me," Fiona said, and ran out the open door. Marion chased after her, but Fiona ran faster, and when she came to the Grove of the Thorn, Fiona leapt, diving into the thickest tangle of branches. As Marion watched, Fiona was transformed. Her arms and legs grew gray as they stretched into branches. Her brown hair coiled into tendrils. Her torso twisted and curved as her skin darkened with bark, and on her face was the merest whisper of a smile as her features faded into the wood. Only the green eyes seemed to stare back at Marion, until Marion realized that it was not Fiona's eyes at all, but the sprouting of brilliant green leaves on the branch. Marion stepped back and saw that throughout the once barren thorn grove, leaves were growing, thick and green. The thorns changed into stems, and at the end of every stem appeared a rose. The roses bloomed pink and fragrant, lifting their petaled faces to the sun. As Marion walked back to where her husband and her brother stood waiting for her, rose petals drifted in the wind and swirled around her. She laughed as she caught them in her upturned hands.